Welcome to Brass Tacks. My name's Eric.
And I'm prospective intern Walker.
And I'm Tristan. And today we are going to hunt a monster.
We just watched the 1987 movie Rock and Roll Nightmare, wherein a heavy metal rock band was attacked by ancient eldritch demons. We're joined today by prospective monster hunter and metal enthusiast Walker, who famously in his job interview said, "Wait, you guys hunt monsters?"
I honestly thought I was answering an ad for Glass Slacks, a businessman's glass-blowing outfit. Anyway, I'm glad to be here, Rick and Chris.
All right, so our movie picks up at a farmhouse in the middle of nowhere, where a hopeful hair metal band seeking inspiration to record their upcoming new LP soon find themselves in a furious confrontation against the Prince of Darkness himself. But it turns out that the lead singer, Thor, was actually the intercessor, and had pulled a fast one on old Beelzebub, having created thought forms of his bandmates based on stock horror movie characters, effectively gaslighting Asmodeus.
What a twist!
By the way, gaslighting Asmodeus is the name of a really good prog rock doom metal band.
Thanks, Walker. Gentlemen, what would you say your favorite parts of this movie were?
Well, first off, there's the music. This was totally my jam, all the synth and the rock all the time. Besides that, there were those one-eyed finger demons. I kept picturing them on The Muppet Show or Sesame Street, you know, maybe hanging out with Oscar the Grouch while smoking.
My favorite part was Phil, the band's manager and pork pie hat aficionado. So what Phil lacks in a sense of directions and general admin skills, they describe multiple times how he booked them in the wrong rooms and gets lost in the Vatican and things like that. But he makes up for it with his dedication to the band and his stellar cooking skills. And throughout, he is shown to really enjoy rocking, as in like wearing rock apparel at all points of the movie. Also, he has an absolutely brilliant scene with caretaker Carl, who malaprops Rod Stewart and Alice Cooper's names when discussing who is recorded in the barn. My least favorite part, if there's a least favorite part to this movie, is the coffin bed, where John Triton and his mental girlfriend share the night, and the coffin bed is a great way to bark your shins when you have to get up and drain the dragon in the middle of the night.
Coffin bed impractical, though it did really tie the room together. I'm gonna say my favorite part of this, it's a mix of things. It's the ambiance that they provided. There's Chekhov's hacksaw, there was the Stig, there was the Jon Mikl van, and that incredibly ponderous approach to the farmhouse that took about 10 minutes at the beginning of the movie. All the supporting details were fun, but really, the thing I gotta say stood out to me the most, the thing that I enjoyed the most, was the Stig. He was like this Canadian Bill Paxton, and I kept waiting for a demon to attack him and leave him staggering around muttering, "It's game over, eh? Game over."
That's it, man. Game over, man. It's game over.
Plus, he wears his sunglasses at night. To fuck.
It should be noted that Stig was the drummer of the band, and you guys are not going to believe this, but that accent he has, stellar as it is, that actor is not actually Australian.
Ooh, who would have known? He was so convincing.
Indeed.
This movie, we've mentioned a couple of times, Beelzebub, Asmodeus, the Prince of Darkness, a lot of different names thrown around, but really we're talking about Satan and his evil Muppets. Eric, what would you say this rates on the Brass Tacks monster scale?
Very low. I'm giving him a 3.1. This is clearly not the actual Satan, no matter what John Triton says. This is merely a minor devil putting on airs. This thing is even less impressive than the one in the gate. The small creatures, they're dangerous to the unaware, but they're using ambush predator and seduction tactics, and forewarned, we are thus forearmed.
I would have given him a little bit higher rating. I'd say about a 3.6 on the scale. He's at least as strong as, or approximately as strong as one Jon Mikl Thor, which will now
and
be
his
our
pecs.
With his quad pecs, which we will now use as a standard of measurement for strength. He is very good with illusions and patient. having waited in this desolate Canadian farmhouse for years. But he also got beaten by a single shirtless man in a van. So I
could be better.
Yeah. I just being the new intern here, I haven't been read in on the scale yet. That's saved for the second year interns. But I'm thinking this is going to be pretty low, since all this horror was localized to a small farm in rural Canada.
So our scenario we're looking at, as presented in the movie, is John the Intercessor Triton is heading out to this rural Canadian farmhouse, and he's bringing along with him brass tacks, because he thinks we got to get shown the ropes, because we are not up to his level of intercessing yet. So we take a ride in the Triton van out into the remote Canadian wilderness and do battle with the Prince of Darkness. Where I will start my preparations is where I usually start with demonic threats, the library. Consulting the writings of Jorge Luis Borges' The Circular Runes and adapting 20th century Theosophist interpretations of the Tibetan Sprolpa. I will seat myself by a campfire and stare into the flames as I open my third eye and create a tulpa, a thought form to aid me in battle against the Dark One. And I must create a tulpa who don't need no instruction to know how to rock. A pure expression of 80s synth rock who is also a powerful warrior. I need a Buckaroo Banzai.
Okay, well, I think I'll spend most of this weekend awkwardly avoiding, you know, lessons with John. I'm going to rely on the old faithful shotgun and blessed shot. I'm not really comfortable with his oil-slicked, spiky, codpiece-wearing methods. And he seems entirely too self-confident to take any suggestions or methods from us. I'm not really sure this exchange is going to be profitable for either of our groups. This is kind of the opposite of our exchange with Doctors Armitage and Fay in Episode 12, The Dunwich Horror. Picture this scene. There's John Triton, oiled and spiky. He's wrestling with the Dark One, his eyes glowing with his holy power. Along the wall, awkwardly stand Tristan and I, shotguns in hand. Hey, John? Do you want me to shoot him?
Nay, I have the fiend well in hand.
Okay, that's fine. I was, you know, just wondering. But if you've got things in hand, you know, you do you.
I do think that we would really get along with John Triton, Jon Mikl Thor. I think we really appreciate his philosophy on vans, though.
That was a kickin' van.
Kickin' van.
Well said. Well, what do you say, fellas? We get down to brass tacks. Eric, are you going to take this job?
Well, it's really awkward to turn down a job from a supernaturally powered colleague in the monster hunting field with decades of experience. John Triton, for all his eccentricities, is so well known amongst the monster-aware public that turning down his offer could have a negative effect on our future business relations and contracts. We have to take this trip with him, even though we're not getting paid, which is the real tragedy.
Well, I, for one, am thrilled to receive his insight into the shadowy world of professional heavy metal monster fighting. If he can teach me how to manifest an entire band's worth of tulpa detailed enough to fool the Lord of the Flies, that makes the uncomfortable van ride to rural Canada totally worth it.
But he's going to make you wear the codpiece.
And you'd be a fool to pass this up.
I don't know, guys. I've been thinking about this pretty hard. Being your intern has been great and all, but I don't know. I might have to look into John Triton's program. What's your health insurance like? I'm over here, and I'm Googling the cost of 20 ounces of baby oil, and I could be doing that with a fantasy 80s groupie. A spiked codpiece might be a small price to pay for that. And bonus, John Triton makes magic water heaters.
Wow. I can't believe our intern is ditching us for the guy who takes 3-hour showers with his own shadow tulpa. I'm not going to lie, though. Insurance is horrendously expensive for brass tacks. We usually only buy it for our interns every other year.
Yeah, this ain't your year.
Oh, man.
Next year doesn't look good either.
Aw.
So in closing, would you recommend this movie?
Yeah, it's a pretty fun, campy little monster movie, like a demonic 10 Little Indians.
Well, I think I actually would recommend this movie. There were some slow bits in the middle, but in the end, I had a lot of fun. And the twist ending where, you know, it turns out that the intercessor was the man all along, that was a great payoff.
I really like the twist ending, too. And I like the murder puppets. But the movie, for me, became utterly unbelievable when they had the self-involved groupie. And this was in 1987. She had her drinking a regular Coke. Any self-respecting groupie with teased hair in 1987 is going to have a Diet Coke. That was just totally unbelievable to me. Yeah. The only unbelievable thing about this movie.
The only one.
The only one, yeah. Yes.
Well, fair point. That being the case, what would you folks at home charge to risk your life against the evil one?
Thanks for listening. I'm Eric.
I'm Walker the Intern.
And I'm Tristan. This has been Brass Tacks Episode 21, Rock and Roll Nightmare.
And as said in the movie, I'll see you again, old scratch.